of the final week of Christ's life. John, if you remember, is the last of the gospel writers to write. By the time John is writing the gospel by John, the other three, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, had already been written and disseminated for three decades, probably 30 years of reading and rereading those gospels when John was inspired by God to write this final. So when we look at Palm Sunday in John 12, and we'll start there this morning, it's the final picture that God inspired of that final week of Christ's life. Just a little perspective, the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are 89 chapters long. They cover 42 months of Christ's life, 3.5 year ministry. I mean, there's little parts about his birth, but the bulk, the vast majority, 90% of them are the 3.5 year ministry. So 89 chapters, his 3.5 year ministry, the final week is 28 of those 89. So like a third of all the chapters are about this final week. So we know more about Christ's final week than any other week in the Bible. There are 28 chapters written about 7 days. And it's just an incredible richness. But we're going to be reading in just a moment, starting in verse 12. But I want you to think about what a day this was. Palm Sunday was the kickoff of the greatest week in the history of the universe since creation. When Jesus spoke the universe into existence, that was a great event. But the universe groaned under the bondage of sin. And so when Jesus rode into town on Palm Sunday, the whole universe knew that it was nearer and nearer to the liberation that's going to come. Romans 8 explains that the cross of Christ was the power to liberate the universe from the curse and the bondage that it groans under in sin. It's not just humans that have been affected by sin. The whole universe has been affected by sin, as we'll learn more about with the answers in Genesis. But on Palm Sunday, when Jesus entered Jerusalem, he entered, now this is the critical element I want you to think about. He entered exactly at the time when the Passover observance was beginning. Now, that exact entrance at the exact beginning of the Passover observance is critical, because everything about Jesus coming into town parallels what the people were doing. Right down, as we saw at our Seder a couple years ago, right down to the moment that the Passover lamb was slain in the temple, was exactly the same moment that Jesus said, "It is finished," and bowed his head and died. Everything Jesus did in this final week is paralleling what the scripture said was to happen at the Passover. Amazing. But look at the beginning. Jesus entered into Jerusalem, and we're going to see in verse 12 that he comes riding on a donkey. I want to read to you, before we read that, the quotation from the Old Testament. You might have in a footnote, you might have a little marginal note at the bottom of your page or something that says that this is quoting from Zechariah 9:9. Let me read to you that before we read the scripture, because Jesus is proclaiming himself as the promised Messiah exactly as it was prophesied that he would. He came exactly when the Bible said he would, right then at that Passover week. He came exactly the way the Bible said he would, riding on a donkey. And this is what Zechariah says: "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion," Zechariah 9:9. "Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation." And here it is: "Lowly, riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." Christ revealed his kingship as he came into town, just as the prophet Zechariah had said 500 years before, that Jesus would come into town as the king of the Jews, riding in a lowly manner, having salvation, having all righteousness, but lowly. Amazing. Christ's kingship was exactly demonstrated at the end of the week as he was sacrificed on the cross. But let's just go into how do we apply Palm Sunday. Let's do the application at the beginning. And I just want to get your minds kind of percolating with the truth we're going to hear. The application of Palm Sunday is clear. Jesus repeated over and over in his earthly ministry that if you don't respond to me as your sin bearer, you're going to have to face me as your judge when you die in your sins. Jesus says, I am the one who came to sacrifice myself for you, but if you reject me, you will die in your sins and have to face me again, but not as Savior, as judge. That's the constant. That's why people liked him. And then when they really heard what he said, they didn't like him because he was threatening to them. He was very penetrating. But Jesus Christ, the prophesied king, came exactly as God promised he would. And let's read about that. John 12, starting in verse 12 down through 19. Let's stand together on this Palm Sunday and read the account. You follow along in your Bible, and we'll look at the precision of Christ coming exactly the way God said he would. Verse 12, the next day, a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, verse 13, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him. And they cried out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it. As it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. Verse 16, his disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. Verse 17, therefore the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out of his tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. For this reason, the people also met him, because they heard that he had done this sign. The Pharisees, therefore, said among themselves, You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the whole world has gone after him. On that moment, at that day, as John records, the people felt that the whole world was starting to follow him. But actually, as our choir number said, what are they going to say very soon after? It was a very short-lived response, very emotional, but it was a response to this prophetic event. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, I pray that we would respond to the message of this Palm Sunday because you came on the day the Passover lambs were chosen. You came and presented yourself as the king who would suffer, who would die, who would become the true everlasting sin bearer. Not just a temporary 1 year lamb that would temporarily paint over sin, but you were the Lamb of God that can take away our sins forever. I pray for your truth to penetrate our hearts deeply this morning because you are the God we can trust and we want to trust you more. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. Well, when Jesus Christ entered on Palm Sunday, it was exactly in the way that God orchestrated. It was, as it says here, the people were entering in John 12, 12 for the feast. It was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, or we know it as the Feast of Passover. And everything about Passover, if you read the Passover event in Exodus 12, is so remarkably pointing at what Jesus did. Jesus Christ reminds everyone as he rode into town, as they were picking a lamb. Remember, they all, as a part of the celebration, just like Americans go and get Christmas trees at Christmas time, at Passover, every Jewish family had to go and select a lamb. And that lamb was just a sufficient little sacrifice that would keep them from the wrath of God for another year. So it was a temporary, it's kind of like painting your house and the paint peels off and you got to paint it again, the paint peels off or whatever. It's just a temporary solution. But Jesus came while they were doing the temporary thing as the permanent Lamb of God that was sacrificed. You see, Jesus is the Lamb of God. That is the lamb that only was sacrificed once, not over and over again, that was sacrificed not for an individual or for a family or for a nation, but Jesus was sacrificed, as John the Baptist said, John 1:29, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. You see, when Jesus came into town riding that donkey, he was coming in as the Lamb of God. Their king had to suffer and be cruelly mocked and treated and crucified and die. But they didn't understand that. See, God planned Passover as a vivid annual reminder of what happened in Exodus. You see, God put the calendar of the people of Israel to be central to this Passover event. Everything kicked off in their religious year with this event. It was the cog around which their lives were built. And God designed that because the Passover is a silent reminder of salvation. You say, why? Well, because each family had to have a lamb that was a substitute. And that lamb was innocent and was supposed to be a flawless lamb. And that lamb was to be identified with their family. The scriptures say that 10 people, one family group, if there were more than that, they had to go to another group. If there were less than that, they had to, that's where the minyan comes from. That's in modern Judaism. They have minyans. That's a group, a gathering of the righteous. There were 10 that were covered by a Passover lamb. So we know the population that was in Jerusalem by how many lambs were slain, because there's one for every 10. It was a very regulated thing. But they were looking at salvation as being a substitute, as something that had to die in their place for their sin. And that was God's silent reminder of salvation that was in the backdrop of all of Passover. So God told them that during the original Exodus chapter 12 event, that they had to take this lamb, they had to bring it into their home. They had to kill it by shedding its blood. They had to collect the blood. Do you remember this Passover event? And they had to take the blood and they had to paint it on their doorway of the entrance to their home. And God said, any family that doesn't exactly follow those regulations, a lamb killed, blood painted, that the penalty for not following his regulation would be that their oldest firstborn son would die when the destroyer came through the land. And so there was this strong desire to do it right. And that carried over into the Passover observance that was celebrated for 1,500 years up until Christ's time. And this event was a reminder that the lamb had to be kept. According to Exodus 12, it says that on the 10th of Nisan, now that's the first month of the religious year, Nisan, and on the 10th day of the month, everyone had to go and buy a lamb and bring it home with them. And it wasn't, you weren't supposed to just leave it out with the others. You were supposed to separate it so that everybody got to know that little lamb that represented the family. That's why Jesus rode into town on Palm Sunday when they were all picking their lambs. And he was going, I'm going to be here with you for the week. I'm the one that's going to be sacrificed this week. I'm the one that's the Lamb of God. I'm the one, just like you're picking your little lamb for your family, God picked me for the world. So see, the correspondence was exactly built in by God. We know that for Passover to be celebrated on Saturday, actually sundown Friday night to sundown Saturday night, that the lambs would have to be chosen on Sunday. You see the significance of Palm Sunday. Now, I know there's scholars that have said that it's Palm Monday, but we're talking about the event, not exactly. So if the Passover was celebrated on Friday to Saturday, they had to come in to get their lambs on Sunday, on the 10th, because it was on the 14th. So no matter how you do it, this event works on every calendar. You know, there are scholars that have Jesus being crucified 29:30, 30:31, 31:32, or 32:33. There are all these years, depending on what camp it's in. But it doesn't matter. The same interval is in all of those years. And Jesus rode in when they picked their lamb, and Jesus died when their lamb was killed. It's amazing correspondence. The Palm Sunday event of Jesus' final week was exactly the day that the Passover-observing Jews in Jerusalem not only picked their lambs, they washed their lambs at the sheep gate and the pool that was by that gate. You see, Jesus came from Bethany up over the Mount of Olives, down through the Kidron, and came up on the east side. And as he came up on the east side of Jerusalem, there were literally thousands of families leading little lambs going to that pool where the law said they had to wash them and have them inspected for defects by the priests, because the sheep's pool was right next to the temple. And so Jesus, as he rode into town as the lamb fulfilling the whole Passover event, was just surrounded by all these other lambs that were being led. It's just an amazing correspondence. So Jesus came as the Lamb of God, passed by the sheep gate where all the Passover lambs were being washed and prepared. And on that Palm Sunday, think of what was happening. The promised suffering king was presenting himself to the city as the Lamb of God. That promised suffering king came as a lamb. He came as the one and only lamb. He came as the Lamb of God as he entered Jerusalem on the lamb picking day. And Jesus rode past on a donkey. Zechariah 9 said that. And he came to be abused and falsely accused and horribly disfigured. That's what Isaiah said would happen. And Jesus entered Jerusalem as the one and only lamb. It would be the sacrifice for the whole world. And that's what the last prophet, John the Baptist, said. So Jesus came. And what's amazing is so few even noticed as they were washing their lambs and busily preparing. You see, Passover had become just a hollow religious observance. I wonder how many families really thought about the fact of all the rigmarole they had to do. The dad had to pick the lamb. The family had to come. The dad had to put his hands on the lamb. The priest had to inspect the lamb. The priest had to kill the lamb. The dad had to stand there and watch the blood being caught. And probably the family thought, you know, why don't we just get to dinner? You know, what is this big deal? And see, it just slowly lost the silent testimony that sin needs a substitute. See, that's what it's all about. We can't pay our own bill. Sin is such a big price, a substitute has to pay the bill for us. A temporary substitute was an unblemished lamb. The permanent substitute is a perfect, sinless sacrifice, which only Christ could be. Well, just as on that first Sunday, some chose to cheer and honor and worship Christ and others didn't, we have a choice on this Palm Sunday. I wonder, We're going to be celebrating communion at the end today. As you hold that bread, are you in your heart saying, Jesus, my sins are on you? Jesus, I place my hands on you as my only hope of being my substitute for my sin. See, that's what every Passover, every family did. But you know what? They did it so mechanically that the majority of people didn't even understand what they were doing. It can almost be that way with communion. Okay, come on, give me the bread, give me the cup. Yep, we do this. Is it a time we stop and say, Lord, I put my hands on you. I transfer, as it were, all of my sins to you, all of my guilt to you. You are the one who died in my place. You see, the heart of the gospel is the substitutionary atoning sacrifice of Christ. We call it the vicarious sacrifice, that he took my place. He pushed me out of the way and took the wrath of God for my sin. And that's what every communion is a celebration of. This morning, do you know that you have placed the hands of your faith on Jesus Christ and said, I am guilty. You're the only one that can pay my price. By faith, I believe you died in my place. That's how you lead someone to Christ. You point them first to their guilt and sin weighing them down. Then you point them to the only one that can take and offload that sin. And then you invite them to actually ask him to become their sin bearer. All of us who've been saved, the same process. And Palm Sunday is such a reminder of that. Well, specifically, Palm Sunday reminds us that God's word is unstoppable. Not only Jesus' entrance and not only the purpose of his entrance, that sacrifice for sin, but the prophecies that surround it. In fact, there's no other time of all of Christ's ministry that's so surrounded by prophetic promises as this final week. In fact, just in Christ's crucifixion, there are 33 different clear prophecies that are fulfilled. But I just want to show you some little ones, because we're going to cover those other ones as we get closer to the crucifixion on Good Friday and then on Resurrection morning. Let's just talk about the events surrounding Christ's final day. Not the cross, but just the run-up to the cross. Let's turn specifically to Matthew 26. Turn back in your Bibles from John to Matthew 26. And there's nothing in all of human history that compares to the prophecies associated with the events surrounding the substitutionary death of Christ. There are scores, there are hundreds of prophecies in the Old Testament that focus on the death of the coming Messiah, but all were recorded literally hundreds of years before they took place. In fact, as we go to Matthew 26:67, I'm going to be reading where you are, but then I'm going to be reading from the prophets. And I want you to understand what's happening. The Old Testament prophets, 1,000 years before the crucifixion, began writing all of the minute details of how, when Jesus came into town as the substitute lamb, that he was going to be treated this way. They were going to do this to him. They're going to sell him out and betray him for this price. They were going to kill him in a certain manner. But before all that took place, they were going to mistreat him in specific ways. And what's amazing is the specifics of Christ's final day on earth, the specifics were written 1,000 years before those events took place. It's just astounding when you read it. The prophetic exactness of Christ's final night. Each element of Christ's final night speaks loudly of God's unique prophetic power. The cruel treatment, the Bible says, of Christ's back, cheeks, and face. Now, the Bible pulls out those three. It says that he's going to be cruelly treated and abused on his back, on his cheeks, and on his face. Now, that sounds kind of vague until you read what Matthew says. Exactly what God said would happen does happen, and what makes it astounding is that was predicted 600 years before. Look at verse 67. It says, "Then they spat in his what? Face, and beat him. Others struck him with the palms of their hands." And then if you read a few verses later in verse 26 of chapter 27, it talks about they scourge him. So, now we're just, I don't want to run around to Matthew and Luke and John and get you off there, but just in Matthew, he captures this account of the mistreatment of Christ's body. In Matthew 26:67, all the way down through 27:26. But listen to this. Isaiah 50. Now, Isaiah was writing 8 centuries before Christ. 800 years before what we just read in Matthew, this is what Isaiah 50 in verse 6 says. "I gave my back to those who struck me. They struck him with rods before Caiaphas," and in Matthew 27:26, "they struck him with the scourging." So he gave his back specifically. Secondly, it says, "my cheeks to those who plucked out my beard." You know, this week, as a father, you know, sometimes we're called upon to help in emergencies, and one of my children had a bandage on, a little Band-Aid, and they were going, you know how when you pull it off real slow, it pulls every hair possible out. And after they had taken about 1/2 inch and lost about 2 or 3 hairs, you know, they came to me and said, "This is awful. How do you get them off?" I said, "You want me to help? Hold out that arm." Before they even knew what was happening, I pulled it off. And the bandage was off before they went, "Ah!" But it was over. Can you imagine, though, those cruel mockers, as they pulled they would grab handfuls of Christ's beard and pull it right out of his face. A lot of his disfigurement was not just from the Romans, from those hateful servants of Caiaphas that just had their master's venom. So Isaiah saw that in the future, "my cheeks to those who plucked out the beard." And then look what it says, "I did not hide my face from shame and spitting." Now look back at Matthew 26:67. They spat in his face and beat him, and others struck him with the palms of their hands. You see his back to scourging, his beard, cheeks to the pulling out, and his face covered with spit. And that's exactly what the scripture said would happen. Now keep going to Matthew 27, verse 3. Because there are several prophecies about that in the Old Testament. It says in Matthew 27, 3, then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that he had been condemned, was remorseful and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. Verse 4, and said, I have sinned by betraying innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? You see to it. And he threw down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. Verse 6, but the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, it's not lawful to put these in the treasury because they're the price of blood. Verse 7, they consulted together and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers. Therefore, that field has been called the field of blood, or Akeldama, to this day. Now, notice the elements there. There is a betrayer. There is a betrayal price, the 30 pieces. And there is a return of the price and the purchase of a field. That's what happened. And we all know that because it's just part of the account. But in the Old Testament, it says in Psalm 41, my own familiar friend in whom I trusted, he who ate my bread, has lifted up his heel against me. And it says specifically in Zechariah 11, verses 12 and 13, then I said to them, if it's agreeable to you, give me my wages and don't refrain. And they weighed out for my wages 30 pieces of silver. Now, that could be a coincidence. You could say, well, it doesn't say anything about Christ so far. Well, look at verse 13, or just listen to verse 13 of Zechariah 11. And the Lord said to me, throw it to the potter, that princely price they set on me. So I took the 30 pieces of silver and threw them into the house of the Lord for the potter. You see, Zechariah was seeing through inspiration a future event of the Lord talking about something going on to him, about people setting a price on me, and the price on God was 30 pieces of silver, and the pieces of silver getting thrown into my house, the temple, and the 30 pieces of silver being used for buying a potter's field. Now look back at chapter 27 after I just read to you what it said. 500 years, that's the part about the 30 pieces, and 1,000 years, that's the part about the betrayer being a close friend. Listen to what Matthew says in Matthew 27. Judas's betrayer gave the 30 pieces back. Verse 5, he threw the pieces into the temple, that's the Lord's house. And verse 7, they buy the potter's field. Just like the Bible said. Now, just like Jesus came into town on the day that the Passover feast preparation started with the purchasing of the lambs and the washing of the lambs and the bringing the lambs into the homes, so Jesus entered into the lives of the children of Israel in Jerusalem on that day. But that's not the only prophecy. This kicks off a week of the most stunning display of God watching over every single part of his word and fulfilling it. An amazing reminder. So God in every way keeps his promises, and God keeps his word, and God's word is unstoppable. I think when you think of Palm Sunday, you should just think that God keeps his word. He kept his word to send a little lamb to portray the Passover, and that little lamb was Jesus, the Lamb of God. God keeps his word that Jesus was going to be betrayed by his friend. God keeps his word right down to the back and the face and the cheeks. But God also keeps his word that if you don't put your hands on the lamb, if you don't allow him to take your sin, then he said, I'm going to keep my word. I'm going to judge you forever for your sin. You see, Palm Sunday is a day that we need to think about, that God wants us to be sure that we have applied the blood of Jesus Christ. They had to, in the Exodus 12 event, apply blood to their house. In all the years after that, they had to apply their hands to the one that was going to shed its blood. And now Jesus said, you must put your faith and hope and only confidence in me as the one who died in your place. Palm Sunday was a day that people chose their lamb. The Palm Sunday application to us as we roll into communion is, have you chosen Jesus as your lamb? Have you said, my sins by faith are on you? My guilt by faith are on you. You're my substitute. Jesus said, if you haven't done that, then someday you're going to meet me face to face. Only I'm going to be your judge. Let's bow and prepare our hearts for communion this morning.